You're listening to the Wise Women Invest podcast, a division of Noise Media Network, hosted by Audrey Bell Kearney. Wise Women Invest is on a mission to help 1 million women learn how to make smart money moves by becoming savvy investors in real estate, the stock market, cryptocurrency, and early stage businesses. Now your host, chief noisemaker, and wise woman herself, Audrey Bell Kearney.
Good afternoon, good evening. Not afternoon, it's evening. Good evening. Good evening, world. Good evening, Carolyn.
Good evening.
How are you today?
I am doing great, Audrey. It's so good to see you today.
Same here, Carolyn. It's been a busy day. I've been out all day looking at buildings and all kinds of stuff. I'm exhausted, but I just left a wonderful, let me tell you. So Gas South, it used to be the Infinite Energy Arena down on Sugarloaf. And I guess they changed the name of, the sponsor of the building. So now it's called Gas South, but they've done some upgrades and it is a beautiful building. And I hadn't been in there since, I think I went in there, not even last year, cause I didn't go anywhere last year. 19, that was the last time I had been to an event there, and they were just finishing up the parking lot. Now the parking deck is completely done, and they also made some alterations to the building itself. I think that building is new. It's really nice in there. So we were in the lobby area, and the lobby area has to hold about 300 or 400 people, because it was about 150 people there on one end, and the whole end on the other side was totally empty, which is crazy. So it's really nice. It's really nice.
Nice.
So I just left it.
I haven't been over there in a while as well since the pandemic. I need to get over there and see that, especially since the renovations are done.
Yeah, it's beautiful in there. So it's I was like, this is beautiful. So yep, so that's where I've been today. So listen, we're gonna be talking today, Carolyn, because you know a lot of people, they've heard of an IRA or IRA, they've heard of a Roth or a Roth IRA. And I think a lot of people still don't know the difference and why it's important and how to get started in investing in a Roth. And which one do you choose? Because I think, you know, it's a confusion when you hear. And let me tell you a quick story. And this is before I knew what I was doing. My mom had some money and she put it in a regular IRA. And she would watch it, Carolyn, like watch it fluctuate. And so her money kept going down and she freaked out and she took all the money out because she's like, oh my God, this is not working. I'm losing all my money. And this was years ago. It had to be 15, 20 years ago.
Right.
And I was trying to explain to her, listen, just leave it. That's not for you to take out right now. It's going to fluctuate. So a lot of people don't understand that part. And so she had a traditional Roth, or traditional IRA, and she just did not like what she saw. And she took the money out, got hit with a penalty and everything, took the money out. She's like, I don't care what you say, I'm about to take my money out of this thing. And so she didn't listen to me. But so there are going to be some people right now who want to know what's the difference and how do I invest and which one do I choose?
Okay. Well, every time we talk about investing, we always have to remember that it is really individual specific. And so it's not investing and saving is not a cookie cutter type thing. You can't say, I'm going to put everybody here, I'm going to put everybody there. It all depends on a person's, their age, number one. It depends on how long they have to invest, if they're investing for retirement, because IRAs are considered retirement, pretty much retirement vehicles. And you know, IRAs are really it's a law. You know, it's when you think about it as an investment, it's a law. It is something that the federal government passed, and there's a senator or somebody associated with it. So it is a law. And so when you are determining which one to do, it all depends, I guess I said, on your age. A traditional IRA, your money grows, and it all also depends on where your money is invested, okay? So the vehicle is a traditional IRA or Roth IRA, but how the fund works or how it happens is based on what it's invested in, okay? So the traditional and Roth are the types of investments. With the traditional IRA, you put your money in there. You can either do a lump sum or you can do a monthly draft. And with the traditional IRA, you can't take the money out until you're 59 and a half. And if you take the money out before you're 59 and a half, you're taxed on it because it is earmarked for retirement. Okay. And you're taxed on it. You're taxed on it when you take it out. The difference between the basic difference between a traditional and a Roth is with a Roth IRA, your money is tax-free when you take it out. Okay, because there it's your money is going in there already taxed. Okay. So traditional IRA, your money is going in pre-tax. Roth IRA, your money is already taxed, so it's free when you take it out. The other thing with the Roth is that you can actually take out your money after the Roth has been established. If you're 59 and a half, after the Roth has been established for at least 5 years, you can take some of your money out without any penalties or anything, which is different from the traditional IRA. The other thing with the traditional IRA is that you can deduct that amount from your income tax return, whatever you're putting in the IRA on a monthly basis, or whether you do a lump sum, you can deduct that amount from your income tax return. A Roth IRA, you cannot, because you know that's tax-free when you take it out of there. You can start a Roth IRA at birth. You can actually set up a Roth for a kid at birth. Yes.
Really?
Yes, you can. It's called a minor IRA, minor Roth. You can set that up at birth. I think the last age is probably 80 years old in order to start it. And with the traditional, you have to start taking the money out once you turn 70 and a half. Go ahead.
So, Carolyn, so if you start a Roth for a child, let's say the child is 3 years old, you say, you know what, I'm going to start a minor Roth IRA. That is still earmarked for retirement, correct? They can't get it out once they for education or anything like that. It has to be for retirement. Okay.
No, you can do what's called an educational IRA. And that's the whole thing with there's so many different types of ways that you can start saving for kids, but you can do an educational IRA that is geared, that's earmarked for when they get ready to go to school. The Roth IRA, a lot of parents who do the Roth, the minor Roth, but they say, you know what, because I just did a client yesterday and she said, you know, I think I'm going to just put him in a regular investment account and let's not do the IRA. And I said, well, she said, because one, they, well, here's the other thing. At 21, it converts over to the child when they get to be age 21. She said, I'm not wanting anything converted to him. When he gets to be, I want to be able to control it all. So set me up a regular investment with his name on it and my name on it. And that way, and I'll just pay the taxes on the growth, you know? And so again, as I said before, every single investment depends on the individual. It depends on what their timeline is, what their goals are. If they want to save because we also have college funds, you follow, that are there, that are earmarked for a person. Some of them you can actually roll over to somebody else if your child doesn't go to school. So it all depends on the person. We don't do cookie cutter investing, and we want to teach our ladies that to just talk to, let someone just tell you, this is what you need based on what they're marketing to everybody. Every single person needs to be looked at differently, because you know, when it's like I was talking to someone earlier today, Audrey, about the fixed indexed annuity, and they were like, well, I think I want that. And I said, well, let's talk about what your time horizons are, let's talk about your age, let's talk about how you're going to fund it, and by the time we got, and what her liquidity is outside of her investments. And so when we got through with all of the discussions, it wasn't a good fit for her. Mm-hmm. You know, she wasn't even ready to do any type of lump sum, which she thought she was. So it all depends on the person. A Roth IRA, though, I will tell you, is one of the best vehicles that a person can put their money in, because of the fact that when they get their money out, it's tax-free. Every other investment that's out there that's earmarked for retirement, when you start taking the money out, it's taxed. So, Carolyn, IRA is taxed. Yes.
Let me ask you this. So if that's one of the better ones, the best ones, why would people choose a traditional over the Roth? If it's the, you know, because I'm thinking I'm gonna go with the one that's gonna give me the more benefits and perks and more, you know, flexibility. What would make someone choose a regular traditional IRA over a Roth?
Mostly it's because of taxation. For example, you cannot, like, so if something has grown tax deferred, let's say, here's an example. You have $100,000 in your 401k that has been growing tax deferred, right? Mm-hmm. And so you have not been taxed on that money at all. So that's pre-tax money, tax deferred. You cannot roll over a 401k into a Roth IRA because the Roth IRA money is already been taxed. You follow? Mm-hmm. So you have to roll over that into a similar type vehicle, and that's the traditional IRA because that particular money. So a lot of it had. Remember, I tell you, it's a law. So it's a lot has to do with the taxation of wherever the money is coming from. So if you're in a we call them like account to like account. So if you're in a 401k and you want to come out of there, you have to go into a traditional because that's a like fund and you haven't been taxed on that money.
Okay. So yeah. I want to go back to one thing you said. So you said a parent can do a educational IRA, but they can also do a 529. What's the difference between the two? Because I've never heard of educational IRA before, but I've heard of a 529, and I think that's one of the best ones out there. What's the difference between the two?
Okay, so the educational IRA is very similar to just we talked about with the IRAs. It grows tax deferred. It is, but it's earmarked for that one person. So if you set up one for Johnny, then that's for Johnny. Period. The 529 and the IRA, of course, has the tax benefits as well. The 529 plan is a educational plan that is earmarked for education. But here's the caveat. It's the education of whoever the owner of the contract wants it to be for. So remember that. So the educational IRA is for one specific person. The 529, if Johnny decides not to go to college, then mom can say, okay, I'm going to go to college and I'm going to use it. Or mom can say, oh, since Johnny's not going to college, I'm going to give this to Beth. And Beth is going to use it to go to college. And you can continue to use it as an educational purpose. The monies, and again, it grows based on where you invest it. Just like with the Roth and the IRA, so those are types, okay? So when you start to invest, you're going to look at where am I going to put this? So as you're setting up the account for the individual, because it's based on the person, you're going to ask questions about their liquidity. You're going to ask them what their thermometer is for the fluctuations in the market. You're going to ask them, you know, how quickly do they think they're going to need the money? Because if they're going to need that money within the time that before they're 59 and a half, they're going to pay penalties on it. They're going to pay penalties. They're going to pay taxes and a 10% penalty for taking the money out. So you're going to ask all of those questions to determine what is going to be the underlying investment for this particular vehicle. Is it going to be aggressive, which means, of course, you know, it's going to be in the market, and whether or not their stomach can handle that is something that we have to determine. If they're going to be middle of the road, where there'll be a little bit of market and a little bit of bonds and something secure and fixed, or are they very conservative? And if they're very, very conservative, then we need to put them in something like we talked about the last time we hear bonds and municipal funds that will not have that kind of fluctuation in the market. And that doesn't mean that it's not, you know, that they may not have, they may have losses or whatever. It just means that because it's more conservative, the likelihood of them losing large money is very, very slim.
You know, it's so funny because I was in a meeting earlier today with one of the chambers here, and bonds came up as a way to secure a building for the chamber. And I was like, yay, you know, I just talked about this last week. So that was pretty cool. So we got to have more discussion about that. So I'll be sure to bring you in on that when the time comes. The building is such a huge project, though. Like, it's a humongous project for, and, you know, I told it, you know, the chamber president, ooh, you got a lot of work ahead of you with this one because it's such a big project. But they have to find a way to fund it. And buns was a topic of discussion. So that's pretty interesting.
Yeah, it is quite interesting. And that's, again, that's the way they raise money. And, you know, I have, I think I shared this with you once before, and I may not have because I talk to people all day long. But I had a young lady who told me that she wanted to look at diversifying her portfolio by adding a bond fund in there. And so we just have to decide where, because she's from, I think she's from Illinois. She's from Chicago. Yeah, she's from Chicago, and she now lives here in Atlanta. So she was trying to determine whether to do something that encompasses a lot of different states or whether she should find something that was just for Georgia. And we're doing some research to see what types of things Georgia has right now. And it's not, and again, we're not investing directly into Georgia. We're investing in a mutual fund that's investing in that. And back when we were talking about the traditional and the Roth IRA, one of the best, when we're looking at where we're putting that, typically is in mutual funds. You know, that you can fund an IRA with the CD as well. You know, but it's the type of where you're going to put it, what kind of growth you're looking for. And of course, you know, if somebody puts it in a CD and it's an IRA, you know that they are very conservative because CDs have not yielded great rates of return for a long period of time. But it is a type of savings that people like, people who don't like the volatility of the market. They do choose to leave their money in the bank in a CD. And it's amazing, Audrey, how many people literally leave their money in the bank. It is amazing. You know, and a lot of it is because they don't know. You know, I was doing a women's meeting on Sunday, and a lot of them were saying it's because they didn't know. Quite a few ladies had husbands had taken care of their investments, so some of them were widows. So the husband had taken care of everything, and they didn't really understand it. And so it was really a really good being able to share with them. Yes, there's a difference between a traditional and a Roth. Yes, you can have a CD. The key with your investment is to have diversification. And if your traditional IRA is what you have, look at where it's invested in to make sure that you're diversified, that you're getting the kind of return that you're looking for. And you can always switch it. You know, that's the other great thing. You don't have to stay where you start out. Once you learn, you can move to another level. You know, you can have a traditional and a Roth. You know, but of course there are investment limits per person for each one of them. Okay, so every year, I think this year is $7,000 for the Roth IRA. So you can max it out. And then for a self-employed person, there's something called a simple IRA that allows them to put away a lot more money than a person who's just investing. You follow? So I think it's like $22,000 instead of seven for a business owner. So there are a lot of different investment vehicles out there, but it all depends on the individual and making sure that we answer the questions that they have, and also looking at what all of the things that they want to do with their money.
So now with the amount that you can invest in a Roth and a simple based on which one you choose, does it have to be, can you, like, let's say for instance, I'm a self-employed person and I want to set up a simple IRA because at some point I may get tired of being an entrepreneur and I just want to retire, you know? And I want to invest this $22,000. Now, is that pre-tax, after tax, and can I put it all in at one time, or do I have to spread it out over months? How does that work?
No, you can put it all in at one time. You can put it all in at one time, or you can set up systematic monthly drafts. Like I did, I talked to a young lady, I think that was Saturday, and she said, okay, here's my plan. I got to put in $7,000 for 2022. I'm about $1,000 short for 2021. I said, okay, you have until April 15th, to put in the rest of that $1,000. She said the first of the year, I want to start a monthly draft that so by the end of the year, I'll have my $7,000 in there. So you can do that. Or if you have money someplace else that you can put in a lump sum, you can do that as well. And then you can also do what's called quarterly or as quarterly amount. So if there's so many ways you can put your money in there. For people who don't have lump sums of money to put in, you can say, okay, I'm going to start with $50. And then you can also just pour in. Let's say you do a contract or you do something that's going to give you a sum of money that comes in and you get in $2,000. You can send that directly there without having to, no penalties or whatever, to put that money in there. So you can do lump sum, quarterly, monthly, as long as you don't exceed that amount in that year.
Now, is the only difference between a Roth IRA and a simple IRA the fact that the amount of money that you can put in there, is that the only difference between the two, the amount that you can actually invest annually?
Yes. And if the simple does not, that money is not tax-free when you take it out, but the Roth is. That's the other difference, that the Roth is tax-free. It's tax-free when you take it out.
You can put in up to $22,000 in simple IRA, but you're going to get taxed at 59.5 or later when you take it out.
That's correct.
Okay. Gotcha. You know, it's so many things about, it's so much information about investing. And every time I think I'm going to run out of things to talk about on this show, I hear a whole lot of other things just start spinning in my head. And I know that we'll probably never run out of things to talk about when it comes to money and finances and creating generational wealth. We probably never run out, because one of the main things we talked about a little bit is really getting your mindset adjusted to just even talking about this stuff. Because in most homes, people don't talk about money. Like, that's like a taboo in most people's homes. Like, you talk about money and everybody just clench up, like you said, hey, cut off your pinky toe or something. You know,
you're so right. It is sad. There are two things that houses don't talk about a lot, and they should, and that's money and life insurance. Two things, and life insurance is probably worse than money. They will sometimes talk about money before they talk about the life insurance, but those are two things that are so instrumental in making sure that a family's real picture is secure. You know, knowing the money, and the sooner you have the discussions about money, the better. You know, because our kids grow up and go to college, and if they don't have some type of foundation about how to save money, how not to spend it all, how to budget, they're going to end up in debt and in trouble before they get out of college. You know, and so we have to make sure that we start having those conversations with our children as early as possible, have them with our spouse so that we're on the same page. And I'll tell you, there's so much, you know, we haven't even touched the surface of so many different things. Like you and I talked about doing a show about fixed indexed annuities, about, you know, annuities period. There's so much more and so many different levels that we can continue to talk to and add information to the people who are listening to us. And I would say too, Audrey, that's so important. You know, I always remember that the topic of this is Wise Women Invest. It is so important that women know what they have in their household. You know, what type of investments do your husband have? You know, what do you have together? You know, do you have something that makes sure you're the beneficiary on? So you have to have those money conversations so you're not surprised to buy it when something happens.
Yeah, I had a potential client reach out to me, I think it was yesterday, and she came to me and she said, you know, do you think I should get insurance on my dad? And I said to her, well, did you talk to your dad? And she said, I hadn't talked to him, but I just think, you know, I don't know if God forbid something should happen to him, what should I do? And I said, well, you might want to have that conversation with him first. I said, because the one thing my mom always said to me, you don't want to cry both ways. One, because you lost the person, and two, because you can't put them away the way you want to. Because she said you're going to cry both ways. And she used to always say that, Carolyn. And she would tell us, she told my brother and I, you don't want to cry both ways. And so I said to her, you know, the worst thing that could happen is you could lose your father. But the second worst thing is you could lose him and then nobody could put him away the way you wanted to. you know. And I've seen people not now today, and I know this is a little bit morbid, y'all, but it's a way of life. More today than any time ever, people are doing cremations. I didn't know so many people did cremations, but they have and some people do really have nice policies. But the person that owned the policy has said to them, "Do not put that money in the ground with me. Cremate me and keep the money." And honestly, Carolyn, you and I both know that because people are waking up to the fact that they do need life insurance, but they have also awoken to the fact that life insurance can start it can start generational wealth if you get enough of it. It really can. And I know you don't want to think about it like that, but if you're smart, you want to think about it like that. Because yeah, you can't stay here let me say this. You could possibly use some of the money if you're still living, depending on the type of policy. That changed too. And that's called a living benefit. Am I correct?
Yes. Yes.
Living benefit. So that's something that was unheard of before. But that, you know, when I found out about that, I was like, what? So let's say, for instance, you got diagnosed with a terminal illness. You could take some of that money and use it while you're alive. That wasn't the case before. So that is now the case. But if you don't make it, God forbid, you don't make it, you can leave your family members well off. Now, what I will say, Carolyn, and I'm sure you're going to agree with me, yes, you can leave them well off, but you need to educate them about money before you leave it to them.
Absolutely. You have to educate. And it's a terminal illness rider. And so, yes, you are so right, Audrey, and all that you said. We want to make sure that you do have the investments, you know, whether that's a Roth or traditional Roth traditional IRA or Roth. You want to have the investments, but you also want to make sure that you're protecting the income in the household. I had a client who called me on Thursday who had a spat with her husband. If she's listening, I'm not going to mention your name, so you're good. But she had a spat with her husband, and she had just increased their life insurance policies. And so she got really upset and said, I'm not paying for this. I want you to cancel it. And I said, okay, are you sure that's what you want to do? You should not make any decisions while you are upset. She says, no, I'm fine. We've got the Roth IRA. We have our 401k. We have investments. We're good. And I said, well, you just started your Roth. And, you know, that's not a lot of money in that. And if something happens to you guys, you want to have that intergenerational transfer of wealth, like right away, like you just mentioned, Audrey, where you can change mm-hmm. the trajectory of your family. And she says, that's okay. I said, I'll take care of it. Whereas, as it would happen on Friday, I got real busy, and then the weekend happened. And then I thought about it on Sunday night, and I was like, oh my goodness, I need to call the office in the morning to take care of that for her. And at 8 o'clock Monday morning, she calls and she says, I hope you didn't cancel that. I said, why? She said, because we're good now. I said, okay. What lesson are we learning from this? I said, because if I had canceled it, and if anything has transpired in his life where he's now on medication or he's sick or mm-hmm. something has happened, there's a probability that it's going to be higher or you may get declined. You know, at your age, you can't play games like that. So promise me you won't make decisions, lifetime decisions based on emotions. So you want to make sure, as we started earlier, you can have the investments, have the retirement, but also make sure that you set up something we call it income protection to make sure you're protecting the legacy of your family.
And you definitely want to educate your family beforehand. I know that, you know, people think that this is like a whole lot of extra time that they got to put aside to learn this stuff. But I'm gonna tell you right now, my mom used to tell me this too. Dead money don't last long. And she used to say that all the time. And trust me, I've had money left to me from people that went right through my hands. And my brother and I were like, what just happened? That's because you know, you think you know what you're going to do with that money till it hits your hand. And then that money just squeezed through. So when she passed away, we did a whole lot of things different because she told us that long time ago, that money don't last long. So if you know that you are getting insurance policies and investments for your family, educate the family now, because once they get that money in their hands, they're going to miss you tremendously, right? But that money is going to burn through their fingers just like they were on fire if they don't know what to do with that money. So you don't want them to have to pay penalties because they want to help and take the money out the Roth because, you know, all kinds of stuff. I mean, I learned so much. I had an uncle, Carolyn, and he had a retirement plan through John Hancock. Had I not known the things that I knew, that money would have been sitting in John Hancock because they told my mom nobody could get it. They was like, no, nobody could get it. Nobody can get it. And for years, nobody got it. And wow. I knew better and I kept fighting and she got it. But they told her nobody could get it. But if you don't know, when you know better, you do better. So Carolyn and I are not here just to try to sell you something. We're here to educate you so you know better. We're here to educate you so you can teach your family better. So if anything should happen to you, they know what to do with that money other than go out and buy a bunch of shoes and a car, right? Because all of that stuff loses value the minute it comes out the store, and half the time it doesn't have any value anyway. So, you know, we are just trying to educate you so you can educate your family so you can make wise, smart money moves, especially if something should happen to you. And if you're planning a future right now, if you have little children, start right now. Like, I didn't even know about the education IRA. I knew about a 529 because that's one of my favorite plans. But the education IRA, I had no idea. So you want to make sure, guys, that you take this information and you use it to strengthen your financial foundation for your family and yourself. And if you're interested in building generational wealth, you want to do that. So for more information, how to contact Carolyn and I, you can go to wisewomaninvest.co, or Carolyn, how can they contact you?
You can reach me at 404-844-8110.
All right. That's our time with you. We'll be back again next week, bringing you more smart money moves and tips to help you grow and to help you create a financial future for you and your family that's solid, solid as a rock. All right. Thank you again, Carolyn, for joining me and always, you know, just sharing knowledge with everybody that's listening and watching around the world. We are syndicated in 5 different locations right now: LinkedIn, YouTube, Facebook, Twitter, and Roku. So we're all over the place. So listen, if you guys want to reach out to us, you have Carolyn's phone number, you have the website, go there, set up a free consultation, get your free assessment. We can do a financial needs analysis. We can help you find your financial freedom number. We can help you pick the best investments for you and your family. We can help you. So this is to help you and your family create a better future financially for all of you. So thank you again for watching. We'll be back again next Wednesday. God willing, people, God willing. Until next time, good evening and make it a great day. Bye, y'all.
Good evening.
You've been listening to the Wise Women Invest podcast. Tune in daily at 6 p.m. for a new investment tip to help you make smart money moves. To learn more about Wise Women Invest and to join our community and investment club, go to www.wisewomeninvest.club. To never miss an episode of the podcast, download the Wise Women Invest app from the App Store and be sure to share the show with another wise woman. Again, our website is www.wisewomeninvest.club.